worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may Jesus is alive. There's a reason why we are not overtaken. There's a reason why we sing on through the night. There's a reason why our hope remains eternal. Jesus is alive. Praise the King, He is risen. Praise the King, He's alive. Praise the King, death's defeated. Hallelujah, He's alive. Hallelujah, He's alive. There's a reason.
Good morning, church family. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, I say welcome to you if you're visiting with us. We're really glad that you are here. We are gathered because we believe what the Bible says about the Lord Jesus, that he, the eternal Son of God, took on flesh, that he was born. We celebrate that each Christmas. Yeah, that he came to die on the cross for sinners and to rise again from the dead. And so we celebrate every Lord's Day. Yeah, Jesus rose up from the dead, and that is why we are here, to worship the Lord together. Yeah, we are glad that you're here. If you're visiting with us, we'd love to be able to connect with you. I want us to pause here as we begin to hear God's word. More than anything, we need God to speak to us. This is what Psalm 103 says in verses 8 and 11. And after I read this, let me give you just a moment to pause and to silently praise God, preparing your heart to worship with God's people this morning. Psalm 103, verse 8. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. Would you pause now and silently, in your heart, praising God for his great love that he has shown to us.
Oh, have many reasons to worship our God, but one of those is the gift of life. And so thankful for this opportunity this morning, for this parent dedication for Sebastian and Scarlett. And as they come and stand before their church family, they were unable to do this several weeks back when we had a larger group because they went back home for a visit to California, which California's loss was our gain. We're so grateful the Lord brought you folks here to be a part of this faith family. And as we come, church, it's important that you know and understand what we're doing. We are not christening a child or baptizing an infant. We are not in any kind of church authority confirming or extending salvation. We cannot do that. Only the Lord can. This is really more about mom and dad than it is about a little baby girl. This is about parents saying we want to commit ourselves to nurture, to raise, to shepherd our daughter for the glory of God, for the good of society. And so to that end, I want to just give you as parents a Bible verse that I was thinking of earlier, and it comes out of the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and the second, or a second, is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." Jesus gave that answer to a lawyer, not a lawyer in the legal sense, but a lawyer who was skilled in interpreting the Old Testament, the Jewish law. What's the best? What's the greatest, most important commandment? And that was the answer, to love God. All your heart, all your soul, all your mind. And this is the best gift you'll give Remy and other children the Lord may choose to give you. And so we want, as your church family, to present you, this is it's called the Beginner's Gospel Story Bible. I've actually read from this to my grandchildren. This is a wonderful resource. And this has kind of walks through the entire Bible, short stories, and a question at the end. I just thought I would read one, not the whole story, but one section. This is the one on Jesus died for us. And it says, on the cross, Jesus showed us how much he loves us. Jesus died on the cross for us, even though he had never sinned or done anything wrong. Jesus died because we do wrong things. Jesus took the punishment for our disobedience and sin. Jesus died instead of us. So it's just filled with great snippets, lessons that are easy for children to see. And we want to encourage you to use this with Remy and family altar times, family devotions. And you know about this. This is a letter that is for Remy on her 10th birthday. And so we will put this in your hands as well. Let me have the joy of praying for you, if I may. Father, I thank you so much for Sebastian and Scarlett and baby Remy. Lord, I'm grateful for their stories of grace and redemption. Father, thank you for what you're doing in their lives. Lord, I know that parenting is never easy. It's has so many joys and blessings, but it's never easy. And so would you give them much grace and much strength and peace and joy and happiness and gospel focus as they, throughout Remy's life, continue to point her to the Lord Jesus. And Father, I do pray that early in her life, Remy will know and understand and believe the gospel, and that she will put her hope and faith in you. And that, Lord, she would live, she would grow up knowing you and living for you. That she would never have any other memories than a Christ-centered home. So would you enable Sebastian and Scarlett to do what every believer strives to do, to love you with all of our heart and all of our mind, all of our soul and all of our strength, and to love others. And may she grow up observing and seeing mom and dad do that. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks. You're welcome.
Lord, our God, He has shown Himself to us in His Word. Would you stand as we sing this together?
Behold.
memory verse for this week is from Revelation chapter 3, verse 20.
Church!
Amen. Okay, so you may know me, you may not. My name's Caleb. If you don't know me, I'm not offended that much, but yeah. So I just want to say this basic verse that actually means a lot to me. So Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him, and he with me.
Amen. Some of you know who is speaking right there is the Lord Jesus. And these are letters that have been written to churches. And this church is maybe one of the more infamous churches. It's the Church of Laodicea. Yeah, you know the issues there. Yeah, they're neither cold nor hot, right? And so God said, would you either be cold or hot? This is useless. I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. Yeah, but Jesus is inviting the church. He's inviting his people. He's saying, behold, I'm standing here as if he's the master of the house. He's coming home. And his servants, he expects them to be ready and waiting for him when he knocks on the door to come in. And there's sweet fellowship. And so I want to invite you to pray to the Lord for his mercy, the forgiveness of sins. For so often, we do not stand waiting and to open the door. And so would you bow your head now and pray silently. God, we confess that we are so often distracted by other things in our lives. Now, we do not open the door when you are knocking. God, we pray for your mercy in our lives and pray that, God, you would be at work in us, transforming us, changing us, that we would desire fellowship with you, to sit and eat with you, to be present as we read your word, God, and as we pray, to be abiding in you. So, God, would you have mercy upon us for your glory, God, and for our good, we pray in Jesus' name.
Seen my Father's glory revealed in Jesus Christ, and the more that I behold him, the more he satisfies. So I gaze upon his beauty as I see him as I should, then my eyes are lifted upward for his glory and my good. Trust the Lord, he will turn my heart towards him and help me bear the thorn. So in faith I follow Jesus on the road not understood, for I know that he is working for his glory and my good. Christ would be made more, would I seek the only kingdom that far outweighs them all. I will stand before my Father where the faithful saints have stood, and with joy my heart shall praise Him for His glory and my good. And with joy my heart shall praise Him for His glory.
Church.
Hello, I am Katie Pilcher. Before I get started, if I have ever taught you in a class here at Woolsey, would you come up here and stand with me? In any form. I don't know about that. All right, again, wow. Okay, my name is Katie Pilcher. I've been a member here along with my husband, Darren, and our son, Austin, for about 7 years. I've been asked to give a little testimony about serving here at Woolsey. Look at this. I was hoping for like 4 or 5 kids. Okay, wow. Before I give my testimony, though, I want to give you a little bit about my qualifications or my Woolsey resume, if you will. To show you that I do have firsthand experience in what I'm about to talk about. This is not to boast, I am no one special. God goes before me and He equips me in everything I do here. All glory to God alone. In the past, I started out with Christy Chambers. Where did she go? Right there. Okay, I started out with her working in the kindergarten and first grade class. That's how I know some of these kids. That was about 3 years ago. I've also been a greeter at the welcome station. This is on the K5 hall. Come on, Bailey. I've been a sub. I taught music in the Roots on Wednesday nights for about a year. I taught VBS Remix a couple of times. I've done Child Care Connect Camp. Currently, I am the lead teacher in the Sunny Day Room. And little Remy over there, she's one of the ones in the class. She was just dedicated this morning. I've also been, for the past 2 years, the champion to the primary faith trainers. Primary faith trainers are parents and guardians of kids here under Trudy's leadership. And my job doing that is to inform and encourage the parents here at Woolsey. We send text messages every week, 12:30 p.m., regarding the lesson they learned that day. We plan and execute 2 big events every year. Coming up next is the Gingerbread Bash in December. Who's been to the Gingerbread Bash? Did you like it? It is very fun. Okay, so these are my general observations. Kids are learning about God here at Woolsey. Remember, I gave you my little resume, so I've seen a lot here. I've been in a lot of different areas. Kids are absolutely learning here at Woolsey. He just came up here and quoted scripture. He memorized scripture this morning. That is amazing. A lot of kids are doing that here at Woolsey. Lives are being changed eternally here at Woolsey. The planning behind the scenes between Brittany and Carrie and Trudy and Jonathan and anybody else involved, It works like a well-oiled machine. Okay? I cannot speak any higher of them. They're very well organized. It's not sloppy. They try to avoid hiccups, and they have an attitude of excellence across the board. Church family should not be cliche. These are my Woolsey kids, by the way. We love these kids like they're our family. We are eager to come alongside you and help you raise your kids in the fear and admonition of the Lord. That's why we do what we do. All right, I've got some reasons why I would implore you to volunteer here at Woolsey. As you know, Arete meets here at Woolsey on Tuesdays, and because of that, we have had a lot of new kids come to Woolsey. The number of kids on a Sunday morning has now quadrupled in size, and they are taking over additional classrooms on the kids' hall. That's amazing, which also means we need more help. Because of Arete, also, there is a large homeschooling presence here, which means on Sunday mornings, parents may prefer to go into a Sunday school class or a connect group in order to have adult conversations. You know what I mean. I homeschooled for 8 years, so I understand. it would give them the ability to go and do that. Okay, next. There's no experimental teaching here at Woolsey. It is effective. Kids are learning. They are growing in their walk in the Lord. Some have professed faith in Christ, and some have been baptized. Fiona was baptized last week, and she's not here today. The curriculum is gospel-centered. If there's no gospel, this is all in vain, and I'm not interested in being a part of it. This is a gospel bag. It hangs in every room on the K5 hall. There's a little description. There's four pieces in here, and it gives a kid-level explanation of the gospel. It's every classroom. We've used these. We practice using these. Let's see. We truly need you. There is no waiting list for volunteers. We are constantly seeking volunteers. That's how I began. They asked my husband and I to help with an outside event, relay races. We volunteered. I volunteered, Darren, but that's another story for another day. And I left that day, and I went to Jonathan Hassel, and I'm like, Jonathan, I actually want to help. And apparently that doesn't happen too often. The Lord just laid it on my heart to do that. All right, next. You may not be aware of this, but New Age beliefs and teachings, witchcraft, occultism, they're on the rise in the world. And some of them have a Christian label, which makes it even more terrifying. It's in schools, it's all over social media, and I kid you not, it's at your local Hobby Lobby store. They sell occultic symbols in some of their jewelry now. Colossians 2:3, Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Kids need a solid foundation in which to build their faith upon, so they can defend their faith when the time comes. It will come. These kids need to hear about Christ from childhood, if possible, Lord willing, just like Timothy did. In 2 Timothy 3:14-15, Paul is writing to Timothy, and he says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which is Scripture, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Okay, I want to address four objections really quick. Someone might say, I don't know how to write a lesson. Well, guess what? You don't have to. It's already done for you. Like I said, the curriculum we use is gospel-centered. It's already done. It's already done. Number two, I'm afraid I'll get stuck volunteering. Well, the cool thing about Woolsey is we use a 5-2-5 schedule, spring, summer, fall. You can volunteer for spring 5 months, summer 2 months, fall 5 months. And every spring, summer, fall, we reevaluate and you have to sign back up again. You're not stuck. There's no contract. There's no fine print. And we encourage breaks. Number three, I'm too old. No, you're not. Noah was 500 when he built the ark. And Methuselah lived to be 969. If you're approaching 300, we might give you a break, but other than that, We just need you to love the Lord. Number four, I don't know how to work with kids. We're not looking for salesmen, philosophers, human wisdom, or lofty speech. The Holy Spirit will empower you. He does the work. I want to end with a quote from John Piper's book, Don't Waste Your Life. Maybe you don't care very much whether you make a lasting difference for the sake of something great. You just want people to like you. If people would just like being around you, you'd be satisfied. Or if you could just have a good job with a good wife or a husband and a couple of good kids and a nice car and long weekends and a few good friends, a fun retirement, and no hell, if you could have all of that, even without God, you would be satisfied. That is a tragedy in the making, a wasted life. He goes on to say, but whatever you do, find the God-centered, Christ-exalting, Bible-saturated passion of your life and find your way to say it and live for it and die for it. And you will make a difference that lasts. You will not waste your life.
Good morning, church family. I'm going to pray for God's mercy, but would you please, if you get an opportunity this morning, would you bring Katie aside and kind of encourage her? As you can see, she's not really enthusiastic about what she talks about, but praise the Lord that we have people just like yourselves, both visitors and members who are here at Woolsey Baptist. And let me offer my welcome to you as well. We have plenty of opportunities here. And if you wanted to come to a church where you were active in things that the Lord is doing, you're in the right spot. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for each and every volunteer that's here this morning. Thank you for the opportunities that you provide. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you that you've given us the wisdom to understand, not through our own discernment, but through your directive, that you've shown us the light of what we should do. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us humble, that we might place others in front of us, that we might be servants just as our sister Katie and serve those that are younger as well as older. Lord, just continue to guide us, use us, empower us, Lord, to glorify your name, to make your name known, that the kingdom would grow, that your light would shine brightly, and the darkness would no longer be seen. And all these things I pray in your precious and holy name. Amen.
God's so loved the world. God so loved the world. That he
praise God that he has sent his son Jesus so that whoever believes in him, whoever comes to him through faith should not perish but have eternal life. We pray that for children. We pray that for adults, for guests here who are visiting us this morning. If you are a parent and you have a child who's in kindergarten or in first grade and you would like for them to be in K1 Bridge this morning, go out through the back and down the hallway to the kids' hall and check them in there. I want to invite all of you to stand as we sing this together. Praise you that you have called us to yourself, that we don't have to follow you alone, but give us hearts, God, that are devoted fully to your son, Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. You can be seated, church.
Hi, I'm Maddie. We are so glad to see you all here this morning. If you're a first-time guest, we'd love to connect with you. Scan the QR code on the connection card in the seat back pocket and let us know how we can contact and pray for you. We'd also love to see you outside at the welcome tent, where you will receive a free gift and talk with Pastor Chuck.
Hi there, I'm Cindy. There is a church conference tonight at 6 p.m. We want to invite you to come as we will be discussing church business, renovation updates, and welcome new members into our church. Child care will not be provided, but children are welcome to join.
Volunteer Roundup is coming soon on October 20th at 5:30 p.m. This is an event for current and interested Woolsey Kids volunteers. If you're interested to see what it looks like to volunteer with kids at Woolsey on Sundays and Wednesdays, this is the perfect time to learn more. Not only will there be a delicious dinner provided, but we get to show you the impact that you can have in the lives of children. Childcare will be provided and registration for this event is live.
Mark your calendars for our annual Fall Festival on October 26th. You won't want to miss the seasonal fun with our church family and community. There will be inflatables, free food, trunk or treat activities, and more. If you would like to help serve at this event, please register on the Church Center app and let us know what area you're interested in.
Moms of preschoolers, B4 Zone is having a Moms Night Out event for you to relax and celebrate the Christmas season with each other. There will be dessert as we make Jesse tree ornaments to use during Advent season. Cost is $5 and be sure to register by October 28th.
The Women's Gather is on November 16th. And you won't want to miss this wonderful event of fellowship with each other as we share in a delicious Thanksgiving meal and hear from our guest speaker, Lauren Mitchell. Cost is $12. Register today on the Church Center app or come see me next to the library after the service to register.
Stay updated with these events and more by checking out the Events or Calendar tab on the Church Center app or online at woolseybaptist.org/events.
Since the dawn of creation, cows roamed this earth. But God created man to protect and care for these animals. The cowboy was made to move these creatures towards better grass and water for each new season. However, some weren't as willing to join this movement. Most cows were willing to go, but some hesitated. Some are tired. Trust us, we get it. And they can be more stubborn, thinking someone else will go instead of them, and maybe bring back whatever it is they need. Some are just plain scared. They don't know what to expect, not sure if they can make it. Despite the struggle that every cowboy goes through, they eventually lead these cows to the food and water that they need to grow into bigger and better cows. It may look like these cowboys are trying to force these cows into doing something, but they're not. They're just trying to encourage them towards what they know is better for them at the end. Just as the cows didn't know how beneficial it was for them to be rounded up, we understand as volunteers it's hard to see why we should serve. I'm tired. Someone else can do it. I'm afraid of putting myself out there. I don't know what to expect. But we are here to tell you that there's a feast of food and water waiting for you. There's a life changed, a soul reached, a kid's day made, because you chose to be there despite the hesitation. At Volunteer Roundup, we'll show you what to expect. We'll help you understand what it's like to serve with kids at Woolsey so that you can influence the next generation.
It's really unfair. I have to follow that. Josh, I don't know where you are, but all that helped produce that, that was outstanding, amazing, made in-house, so well done. Well, please open your Bibles to the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter number 28. I'm going to read a very familiar passage, and then I'm going to just jump right into the message this morning. In the sound booth, I'm going to skip the beginning page, first page on the notes that you see, and jump right into some key ideas here. Matthew chapter 28 and verse number 18. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." Let's pray together. Father, we have been encouraged and blessed this morning in conversations and through the singing of gospel-centered songs, through testimony, through the words that have been spoken already from the pulpit. We've been blessed, Father, even through this reminder, this video of the urgency and the need for people to serve with our preschoolers and children. And so we ask now, as we open your word, that you would speak to us. God, I'm so aware that there are some in this room, some listening online, who are hurting, who are in troubling situations, who need a special touch from you. God, I know others are on the mountain peak of joy and happiness. They're in just such a sweet spot, a sweet space in their lives. And we pray, Lord, that that view from the mountain peak would be one that would urge them to go down to the valleys where others are, where people may be hurting or struggling. Pray now you'll use your word, use this message to impact our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there are four important questions I want to think about with you this morning, and I'm going to give them to you. The first two are going to be the bulk of the sermon. The last two will go just a little bit faster. So the first question is, what are we making when we're making disciples? I mean, our text talks about making disciples. It's the main verb of the passage, make disciples. It's surrounded by a couple of ways that that's done as we're going, as we're baptizing, and as we're teaching. But the main verb, the main point of the passage for those 11 apostles on that mountaintop in Galilee was that they were to go forth into the world and they were to make disciples. So what are we making when we're making disciples? Disciples are followers of Jesus. Disciples are people who have met the Lord, and their lives have been and are being transformed. Now here I'm about to give you some of the marks of a transformed disciple. Some of those indicators are marks of one who has been transformed. And this again is in this key idea that I'm using from our mission sending agency, the International Mission Board, and a training manual that they have put together to equip and send out those missionaries who are going to the ends of the earth. So most of this sermon, or a lot of this sermon, I'm giving my thoughts, my comments on the text. But what I'm about to give you here mostly comes right out of that book called Foundations. But I think it's good. I think it's important. These are six primary marks of a transformed disciple of Jesus. Number one, there's a transformed heart. A disciple is marked by having a transformed heart, by supernatural grace through saving faith in Jesus Christ. They no longer stand guilty before God, but they are declared innocent. They are justified. They are made new creatures in Christ Jesus. Their heart has been transformed. They're now empowered by the Holy Spirit to grow in the grace and knowledge of God. God is gradually, but certainly, transforming a disciple's heart to look more and more like the Lord Jesus. Jot down Titus chapter 3, verses 4 through 8. In fact, I'm going to read it to you. Titus chapter 3, this is a verse that would really explain what a transformed disciple's heart looks like. Titus chapter 3 and verse number 4. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, He saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by His grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. The saying is trustworthy, and I want you to insist on these things so that those who have believed in God may be careful to devote themselves to do good works. These things are excellent and profitable for people. So a disciple is marked by a transformed heart. Number two, a disciple is marked by a transformed mind. His mind, her mind, is being transformed. It's reasoned a certain way. It's responded a certain way. It's acted or reacted a certain way to stimuli around it. But a disciple is now being grounded in the Lord Jesus Christ and in His Word. They begin to read, to hear, to study, to memorize, to meditate upon the Word of the living God. And through the Word of the Lord, the Word of God, the Bible, the mind is being transformed. It's being changed. If you have your Bible, turn to Ephesians chapter 4. If you don't have a Bible, this is in the chair in front of you. Use that Bible, Ephesians chapter 4. It So on page 978 in the chair Bible, I'd love for everyone to see this. Ephesians 4, verse 17, where Paul said, "Now this I say and testify to the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds." In other words, walk is an expression of how one conducts their life. No longer live like the non-believers do. And then he describes them. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learn Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off the old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires. And here it is, just as you put off the old self like old, dirty clothing, you take off those garments, you rid yourself of that, you're putting that away, and you're being renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, like you put on a clean shirt, a clean pair of socks or clothing articles. You put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. A disciple is marked by a transformed mind. Her mind, his mind is being, as it's saturated with God's word, the mind is beginning to change. Number three, transformed affections. We have a renewal of the affections of our minds, our hearts. We love what Jesus loves. We want to turn away from what Jesus would want us to turn away from. We value what he values. We hate what he hates. Our affections are set on the things of God, not on the things of this world, because they're being changed. Look at another passage in the book of Philippians, chapter 4 and verse number 8. That's on page 982 in the chair Bible, Philippians chapter 4, where Paul said in verse 8, "Finally, brothers," this is talking to Christians, implied, of course, are the sisters, the brothers and the sisters, "whatever's true, whatever's honorable, whatever's just, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things." The mind is being transformed. It's progressive, but it is definite. The transformed mind, the transformed affections, and then the transformed will. That's the fourth one. The fourth mark of a disciple, his or her will is transformed. Disciples of Jesus obey God. They want to follow God. They want to obey what his word teaches. They don't obey in order to merit God's favor because they know that's impossible. They've already been saved by grace. There's nothing they can do to earn or merit his favor. But out of faith and love and joy and hope in the Lord Jesus that flows from the gospel, they're being transformed. Their lives are being changed. Their will is changing. Jesus said in John 14, 15, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." A disciple wants to keep a commandment, the commandments of God. They're longing to understand them, know them. They want to know what he says and do it. And then number five, transformed relationships. Disciples love sacrificially. They serve as Jesus served. They want to serve. It comes out of a desire. In John 13, 34 and 35, Jesus talked about how others are going to know our love by how we love one another. Now, we've already heard a very moving testimony about volunteering, about serving, and the need. The video, wow, I just have to tell you, that was outstanding. I had not seen it till just now, And to think that that was made, I call it in-house. Maybe there's a better way, a way of describing it. But that was well done. But here's a couple of things that I want to just add to that. First of all, I hope, church, you're planning to come to the volunteer roundup. If you've not signed up, I hope you're going to. It's not just for food. Food will be a part of it. But I hope you're going to come and learn about ways that you can be involved with preschoolers and children. The ways that you can serve. So this is some information I asked for this week, and I just want to give this to you. I think this is going to be on the screen. What it takes on Sundays and Sunday mornings and what it takes on Wednesday evening to minister to and serve children. In preschoolers, 22 volunteers are needed every Sunday in B4 Zone. Every Sunday that we gather, we have to have 22 volunteers on this hallway to your right to serve our preschoolers. 15 volunteers are required, necessary, every Sunday morning for K-5 Zone. For the hallway that is now, and I can't tell you, I'm so thrilled to see it, almost become a children's hallway, all classes for children. 15 volunteers every Sunday to minister. It takes 4 in K-1 Bridge, 4 volunteers every Sunday. On Wednesday evening, 12 volunteers to minister to the children in Roots. Some of you, your schedules don't allow it. You don't get home from work in time. Some of you may have never been here on Wednesday night. There's a lot of children running around this building on Sunday night. And it is a great thing. It is a wonderful thing. It takes a lot of workers. That's 41 volunteers on Sunday, 12 on Wednesday. Now, I want you to just think about this number here. One more number I want to give you. 72% of evangelical Christians say, by their testimony, that they were saved before age 18. If I were to get a show of hands, how many of you trusted in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord before your 18th birthday? I've seen this. I've asked for it. I've done it. I've seen it many, many times. Most, not every, but many, if not most, hands go up. This is an impressionable season of life. It's a time when people are open. And so as a pastor over the years, when I'm not as directly involved in it now as in the past, but when I have been involved in personally recruiting people to work with preschoolers or children or even teenagers, when I've asked the question, would you serve in the preschool department? Would you serve with children? Would you be willing to take part in this, to invest in a classroom and teach and lead and care for children? There's an answer. I'm not saying I've got this. I didn't get it all the time, but I've heard this. There's an answer I've heard many times. And I'm just going to tell you, on the front end, it's never really landed well. It's just not set well. I never really said anything other than, oh, okay. But here's the answer. Some of you probably know what it is, because some of you, I don't want to make any eye contact at this moment, but heaven forbid I do that. But some of you have heard it, and you've said, well, the truth is, I've done my time. You know what that sounds like? Sounds like you did a prison sentence. I've done my time. Let somebody else do it. I've done my time. I get what that could mean. I get what that means, okay, to a degree. I'm older. I don't, if I do get in the floor, it's going to be hard to get up. It's harder for me to do. I get it. There are legitimate reasons. But friends, I want you to just consider that there are 70 million young people in our country that are in that category called Generation Z. 70 million. So it's a large block of people. Now, this group born between 1997 and 2012, let's don't lose a generation of young people. Whatever that number is in this community, whatever that number, the number is around us, and it's not just the children who are coming. Praise God for all those kids that were up here. But I'm telling you, the many kids that were standing up here with Katie a few minutes ago, there's that many more quadruple that are home today that have not been in a Bible study group, that have not heard scriptures read, that will not hear gospel songs, will not hear faithful Bible preaching, will not fellowship with God's people, that know nothing about the things of God. So it's not just the ones that come, it's those who don't come. So let's don't lose a generation for lack of people to serve. For people that say, I've done my time, wouldn't a better response be, it is my time. It's my time to do it. I'm glad to step up to the plate and do it. Maybe I did it 20 years ago. Maybe I have to have an extra vitamin I, ibuprofen, before I go. But I'm going to do it for the glory of God. I want to serve. I want to invest. Let's don't lose a generation because I've done it before. And then lastly, a disciple is marked by a transformed purpose. They're missionally engaged. They want to make disciples to the ends of the earth. There's a transformed purpose. So we've asked this question, what are we making when we make disciples? Quickly, what is discipleship? What are we talking about? Discipleship is a term that's thrown around. It's used in a lot of ways. I think the IMB, the International Mission Board, gave a simple, very helpful definition. I'm just going to read it straight to you. Not the only definition, but I think a good one. The Christ-commanded, Spirit-empowered duty of every disciple of Jesus to evangelize unbelievers, baptize believers, and teach them the Word of God, and train them to obey Christ as members of His church who are on mission to make disciples of all nations. This is what discipleship is. We tend to think, well, discipleship is a bunch of Christians getting together, and that's all that we do. We just spend all of our time discipling each other. Well, we don't have anybody to disciple if we don't start with evangelism. If we're not reaching people. Again, I couldn't have planned this better. And by the way, for those of you that were watching and I came up here, I did not write Katie's notes. I walked off with them and it hit me. I have more thickness in my Bible than I think I should have. What do I have in here? I realized I had Katie's notes, so I didn't give her talking points. I couldn't have done it as well as she did. I couldn't have written it that good. But to have the children sitting here, would you see in your minds again, folks, this many children who are standing here, many, 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 many more, hadn't been inside a Sunday school class, a connect group, hadn't heard a Bible story, haven't ever been taught like these children are being taught. So this command that Jesus gives is so crucial. Lord willing, next Sunday, I want to share some practical steps. I'm going to share something with you, some steps we can all take to be making disciples. So let me just quickly move on to question number 3. Am I a disciple of Jesus? That's what I want. These questions, the first two are important, but you think about that one. Am I? You ask that of yourself. Am I a disciple of Jesus? Has my heart been transformed? Is my mind being transformed? My affections, my will, my relationships, my purpose? Is God transforming that in me? Can I just tell you, if those marks, when I went over that, if those seem foreign to you, if you're thinking, who would do that? Who does that possibly describe? If those marks are not at least in seed form in your life, if they've never been in your life, you should consider if you're even a Christian. I mean, if you thought, well, he's talking about that transformation stuff. He's talking about people that go overseas, they're missionaries. He's talking about pastors or people in Christian ministry. He's talking about those those people that are really sold out to Jesus. No, if those things seem odd, weird, strange, foreign to you, you might should consider if you're even a Christian. I'm no man's judge. I can't say you're not. But I can tell you there is certainly no evidence or no fruit that would say that you are. But here's the good news. If you repent and if you turn from your sin and trust in Jesus, you can begin to be his disciple. If you just say, God, I need you. I want you. I'm a sinner. I'm lost. I'm undone. I'm without hope. I'm without you. Save me. There's no doubt in my mind. There's no doubt anywhere in the Bible that whosoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And if you call today, your heart will become as pure and as innocent as the smallest child who stood here. And God will begin working something in your life, transforming you little by little, progressively. No matter how much crud and junk is in your history, God will clean you up, forgive you, save you, and he'll start transforming you, and your life will be changed. But it starts with you saying, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm lost. I need you. I turn from my sin and myself, and I'm trusting in you alone. And then here's the last question I want to give you. Am I involved in the discipleship of others? Am I involved in the discipleship of others? Now, Christian friend, regardless of your age or your vocation, every believer should be involved in the discipleship of others. Doesn't matter what you do for a living, you should be a disciple maker. If you work on the top floor of the biggest building in Atlanta, or if you're at the entry-level job of the smallest business in Woolsey, whatever your role, whatever your job, you are to be a disciple maker. You're to be involved in this process. God takes people like us and uses us to disciple others. God does that. In your vocation, in your place, if you're a homemaker, if you're a professional, whatever you do, wherever you are to be involved in making disciples. I want to give some handles to that, Lord willing, next Sunday. But here's what I will just leave you with. Maybe God is calling some of you. You need to think about this. God is calling some of you to go somewhere else in the world and make disciples. God's been calling some of you for a while. Maybe it started when you were in a very young age and God started calling you to go overseas. When are you going to say, Lord, wherever you lead, I'll go? If God's calling you to go to the ends of the earth, there's an unmistakable sense of God's leadership. I'm supposed to resign from my career and my job, or I'm supposed to change my major, or maybe I don't change my major. This is what God has for me to do. When are you going to say, Lord, wherever you lead, I'll go? I don't know if God's calling you to go overseas, but I'm going to tell you, I do know for sure God's calling every dad and every mom to make disciples at home. God's calling every grandfather, every grandmother to make disciples, to invest in the lives of your grandchildren, to make disciples. I know for sure God's calling you to do that. I don't have to try to find some reason to say it. If you're a Christian, God calls you to invest in your children, to pray over them, labor over them, teach them the gospel. There's no pulpiteer that can do that as effectively as you can, dads and moms. No one, no student group leader, no one does that as well as you. Make disciples at home. I know for sure that God is calling every Christian in the room to make disciples in your sphere of influence, wherever you are, wherever you're going tomorrow. However you do that, doesn't mean you clock in and then you emotionally or mentally clock out. You ought to be the best employee a company has as a Christian. You don't cheat company time. You don't abuse privileges. But as you build relationships, as you know people, as you have lunch with people, as you take breaks with people, as you have conversations, you are as effective as anyone on the planet to be a disciple maker. And God's calling us to do that. I know for sure that God is calling us as a church to build one another up, to urge one another on, to spur one another on to love and good deeds. That there's no substitute for that, for those hallway conversations, for those conversations that we have before church, after church, those phone calls, those text messages. Disciple, encourage, urge one another on. So I'm just wondering if there might be among us those that would say right now, right where we are seated, that Lord, I just want to give my life to be a blank page. And I want to sign it. I actually did that. It's just a blank sheet of paper. I put my name, I put today's date, and I'm going to keep this. I don't say I'll keep it forever and ever, rest of my life, but I'm going to tell you, this will be out every morning where I meet with the Lord for my devotional time. I'm going to be seeing this blank sheet of paper. And what I'm wanting this to say is, Lord, wherever you're leading me, whatever that is, I've already said yes. Wherever you lead, Lord, that's where I want to go. I want to ask you to do something. Would you grab a hymn book in front of you? There's a chair in front of you, most of you. There's a hymn book. Turn to page 367. If our musicians would not mind, please, you guys and gals can come ahead. Page 367. You've got your own sheet of paper. No, I'm not going to take them up. This is between you and the Lord to do what you want to with it. But what I hope there might be some of us, I'd love to be as shocked as Katie was when all those children came up here. While a part of me would say, wow, if just three or four people would put their name on their sheet of paper and put it in their Bible and see it. If you never read your Bible, put it somewhere else. Just going to see it. And it's saying, Lord, wherever you lead, that's where I want to go. Let's stand together. Let's stand as we sing in just a moment. Lord, we want to be obedient to you. Lord, we want to say with all of our hearts what this song says, wherever you lead, we'll go. God, some may think, oh, what a waste of paper. But I'm more concerned, what a tragedy for a life to be wasted. Wasted on things that will not matter in eternity, won't matter 100 years from now. But what will matter is, did we invest our lives in making disciples? Were we willing to say, Lord, wherever you lead, I'll go. I want to serve you. I want to be a disciple maker. I don't know how to do it. I don't even know how I'd start. I don't know, God, if you'll take a mess like I've made in my life and if you'll use me. But Lord, if you would, and we know you will you do that? Would you use many of us in this room? Help us, Lord, to say yes, God. Here's whatever you wanted me to do. I've already said yes. I've already signed my name. Fill in the blanks, Lord, wherever you lead. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take up thy cross and
the last verse, verse 4.
My heart, my life, my all I bring to Christ who loves me so. He is my master, Lord, and King. Wherever he leads, I'll go. Wherever
Church. One quick announcement as we finish. First, I want to call your attention to the backs of your seats. You'll see this card, Woolsey Kids. It kind of just gives a rundown of the different ministries that we have here for children on Sunday mornings. And another thing that I'd like to call your attention to is the Fall Festival that's coming up on October 26th. We heard a lot of ways that you can serve within our church here on Sunday mornings and Wednesday evenings, but I think that one way that we can pursue evangelism and discipleship is through the outreach of events like the Fall Festival. So if you will, please sign up. If you would like to volunteer, or you're able to help on the Church Center app. This is a great way for us to serve the children and families of our community. And so it's going to be October 26th from 5 to 7 p.m. on the front lawn.
All right. Thank you, Brittany. And, you know, one of the reasons we do outreach events like this is because people need the Lord, people all around this community. In fact, I have the honor this morning of introducing to you Joy Hernandez and her family. Joy and Callie and Luca, would you guys, men, raising your hand? Thank you so much. They are sitting on my right to your left. And this family started visiting through outreach events like the Fall Festival, Connect Camp, things like that. And got to meet people and eventually attended Discover Woolsey and told me recently that they want to be a part of the church family. We had an incredible time getting to know each other even this past week. And I encourage you to do the same thing. It's a family that we're a part of. And when we're a part of a family, we get to know each other. And so Joy and Callie, Lucas, I am so thrilled for what the Lord is doing in your life and how he's led you recently. Do you guys mind to go ahead and be dismissed right now? Bill Burke is going to be in the temporary lobby, which is out my left to your front right. I encourage you as you leave today to go to your car, or even if you're going out a different way, to make a point to stop by and say hello to this family. Don't forget that Cindy Weatherup is in the lobby, if you will, behind each of you, and those tickets are for sale today for the ladies' event. Also, remember that if you're interested in the volunteer roundup, and after today, I think that should be pretty much everybody in this room, you can sign up at the Church Center app or out these doors to my right. There's more information and sign up. One piece of housekeeping, just for everyone to be aware of, we want to be especially careful with our preschool ministry in the B4 hallway, which is out to your right. If you happen to be sitting in the back of the building and go out that way, please do not cross through that hallway out of respect and safety for the children. You can leave out these doors or go out to the right, but don't use the preschool hallway as a thoroughfare to get to wherever you need to go. Thank you.
Church, I want us to end with prayer. And our sister Carla and Bert are with us this morning, first Sunday back. I saw y'all during the service, Bert and Carla, and you're surrounded by people that love y'all and continuing to pray for you in these days, this hard season. Let's pray and let's be dismissed. Lord Jesus, we love the camps. We're grateful for Bert and Carla and Abigail. We are praying, Lord, for your continued mercy in their lives, day by day, moment by moment. Would you give them your presence, Would they feel that, Lord? Would they sense it? Would they be undergirded by the strength that comes from your word and your people as we seek to show your love? In Jesus' name, amen. We go in his grace.